Howdy, folks.
Oh, did you want to go stand in the near?
I'll wander over. Welcome to the last talk. It's just us standing between you and the most exciting part of the day, which is, of course, the lightning talks. Very glad to be here. I'm Josh Bell. I manage folks working on capabilities in the Bay Area, and with me is...
Hi, I'm Daniel. I'm Chrome TPM, helping out on Project Fugu.
Okay, and so what is Fugu? It's a question we've been getting asked a lot. It's a code name for our renewed effort on bringing new capabilities to the web platform. And we can thank Mike Lothar for the code name. So for those who don't know, Fugu, Japanese name for the pufferfish, which is served as a delicacy, so something you want to go after, something that's wonderful. If not prepared carefully, it can also kill you. So we think this is a pretty good metaphor for bringing powerful capabilities to the web. It also has a really cute emoji. And we have stickers. So if you want those, hit us up afterwards. Yeah, that was working yesterday. OK, next slide. Looks like we're having issues with the remote.
Do you want to try closer?
Clicky, clicky. Okay. Do a song and dance one. There we go. Okay. Hooray. Okay, so very glad to be answering a bunch of questions for you because, as I said, we get asked all the time, what is Fugu? Well, first off, why are we wanting to bring new capabilities to the web? As Ben Galbraith mentioned during the kickoff yesterday, the web has been an amazing source of innovation, opportunity, and allowing free expression. And we believe the web is the best way for people to be able to experience and create content. Dom yesterday, in his talk on PWAs, outlined the overall importance of web apps on the platform. And so I've been thinking about, you know, what's a succinct way to describe why we want capable web apps. Why are we bringing all of these capabilities to the web? Ben Gudger, just as an offhand comment last week, said web apps should be powerful enough to accomplish any tasks that users have. And I thought that was a nice succinct way of sort of almost distinguishing, you know, consuming of content versus interacting with web apps. When a user is intentionally trying to perform some task, web apps are what will let them perform that. And then attempting to outline sort of the core tenets of our project, first and foremost, we want to maintain the tenets of the web for users. That's security, privacy, and their trust of the web. Things are ephemeral, things are secure by default, and so forth. But given that, and with that first in mind, we want to enable web apps to be able to do anything that native apps can, and do so by exposing the native the capabilities of the native platform to the web. So if Android supports something, or Windows supports something, or the Mac supports something, we want to plumb that through into the web. Of course, that's all secondary to maintaining the user's security and privacy. OK. Brief pause while everyone appreciates an XKCD comic. This comic came out in 2011, which is a long time ago. So thinking back to even longer ago, this is referencing an ad campaign from the very early 2000s when some big tech company was contrasting their desktop operating system with another desktop operating system. That was a long time ago. People used to go to stores, these are these brick and mortar things, and you'd buy software in boxes and bring it home. So looking back at that from the perspective of 2011, the world had radically changed. Now, much of the stuff that you were traditionally doing in desktop apps, you were doing on the web. And 10 years later, this has really continued. It's really, if you've been using computers for a long time, hard to imagine the days when you weren't using the web browser for nearly everything. But there's a bit of a gap. There are still some things that you cannot do on the web. And that's largely a gap between what the web is capable of today and what other platforms are capable of. Big area that's different from 2011 is, of course, mobile. Now, most content and apps that users interact with is via mobile. And also, there's the emergence of this little thing that we like called Chrome OS, where you can do almost everything on the web, that almost isn't good enough. We really need to make sure that you can have the full range of applications on Chrome OS so that people can accomplish any task that they want on that platform. So Fugu is about us embarking, taking this leap of faith that we can bring these things to the web while maintaining the security and trust and privacy of the users. And we actually think there is a path forward, a bridge, might not be an obvious bridge, but a bridge forward, if you will, to do so. Okay, so what are some of these gaps? What are some experiences that are not possible today in web apps that are still possible on native apps? What's that gap that we need to close? Obviously, for desktop users, which is a big space that we're going after, there are office suites. We've got one at Google, Microsoft has one, there's probably others out there. So they exist, but they're not full fidelity. There are things like interaction with local files, with the clipboard, interaction with the rest of the elements of the operating system, such as windowing and launchers and menus and so forth, where there are gaps. Also, Pro Tools, and these are things like image editing applications, video applications, audio tools, where native apps still have access to things like the number of processors, the full amount of memory, the low-level audio hardware, and so those apps still tend to remain the ones that people choose native apps over web apps for, because those just aren't as full fidelity on the web. A big one that should be near and dear to the hearts of most of us here are IDEs. I've talked to so many developers putting on my Chrome evangelist hat and saying, yeah, we're making it possible to build everything on the web. And developers will grudgingly say, yeah, you can do that on the web, but you know, not my IDE. I need my IDE to be native. So I think once we hit the point where we've actually moved IDEs to the web, yay, victory, we'll have captured that mind share. In the smartphone space, it's all about social and sharing. And this is about being able to identify yourself, identifying your contacts, and sharing between apps. And if you've seen some of the talks here at BlinkCon, these are projects that are well underway. Two more categories. One is around supporting apps that are being brought to the web, and they make use of existing libraries on native, and there's no good way for those libraries to be brought to the web. One example here would be database applications, or applications that use databases, where a particular database can't be easily brought to the web because there's no low-level storage primitive for it to talk to. So that's not a high-level API. We've got high-level database APIs. What we're missing is the ability for someone to bring their own, and therefore more easily port their existing app, their existing code to the web. So even though they can recompile it with WebAssembly, we're missing the pieces below that for them to use it. And then there's the long tail. How many times have you bought some new gadget, a light bulb, or just got a new fridge, and what wants you to do is download yet another app to control it, and maybe you will use that once or twice and then forget about it. It's the perfect thing where the web, the ephemerality of the web, where it's not going to leave a big footprint on your device, would be perfect. But there's no communication mechanism between that and your local devices. Or other device APIs, you buy some gadget. And this is where it's really the long tail. We're not all going to be purchasing the same gadget, but billions of people might individually purchase gadget here and gadget there. And very often you need to download some native, still desktop application to control it, talk to it over some legacy device protocol. And this is something where you might really want to play with the hardware, but you don't necessarily trust the developers out there offering these new drivers for your system. So again, the web would be perfect here. Okay.
Cool. Yep. So first, I'd like to introduce a bit about like the teams that's working on Fugu, right? So within Google, as you can see, like we're all over the world, right? We have clusters in US, in Europe, in Australia, and of course in Iceland, as you can see for that little fish in the middle of the map.
Go Finner.
So externally, we also have other folks in contributing as well. I'd like to mention two of them. One is Intel, who contributed to WebMFC and other camera capabilities, as well as we have partners with Microsoft, who contributed with launcher shortcuts and other clipboard formats, right? So So one thing I'd like to ask all of you is we love for you guys to get involved with Fugu. So please help contribute. And at the end of the talk, please come to see us and get stickers. We have a bunch at the end of the talk. So one question you ask is, how can you contribute to Fugu? Right? Like many Google projects, we're using Chromium Bug as the source of truth to track the various initiatives within Fugu. Right, so currently what we have done is we prioritize what we believe are a set of equivalent Chrome APIs that can be migrated to the web and a set of partner features, right? P1s are those that we believe that we have enough information to work on and that supports a set of key partner features. P2s are a set of capabilities that we are thinking about working on, but we might need additional information. And P3s are our backlog, right? So if you are a browser vendor, we would like your help. Please go to the CR bug under Project Fugu and look for bugs that is currently unassigned. And then ask us, like, provide information like how you can help and potentially then contribute to that. And then if you're going to be a web developer who want to contribute to Fugu, what you can do is you can look at the capabilities that's inside the bugs, and if there are features that you believe that will that require additional information or you want to bring to the web, please create a bug and help us, you know, list it inside the bug tracker system. So when we're developing an API, we want to follow the standard process as any other browser vendors, right? So we follow the Blink launch process very closely. We really want to interoperate with other browser vendors. What that means is that we will go through the process, such as write explainers, write specs, right? Have a set of web platform tests, right? Do origin trials, do tag reviews, and finally have API owners to sign off. We also want you as the browser vendors to participate in standard meetings like the W3C, WattWG, and YCG, so that we can interoperate all together. So Josh, did you want to give a set of?
Yeah. Okay, APIs? So that's a lot of the theory, a lot of the process that we've put in place. What are we actually building? Well, if you listen to Daniel, you could go to CR Bug and take a look. But I want to do some deep dives into a couple of different categories of things that we're working on, and then quick run through, time permitting, on the APIs that are in flight over the next several months. Okay, so the one that everybody has been asking about, and we've already had some breakout talks about this here, is file system integration. This is, if you run the numbers, by far the most heavily used Chrome Apps API, and every partner we talk to, internal, external, is interested in this. Years ago, Chrome did a file system API that was sandboxed, so you could like IndexedDB, write to files that were only visible to that origin. And when we talked to other browser vendors, the feedback was, yeah, that's not really interesting. The customer demands that we have are native file access. And we were like, great, let's work together on that. And feedback was, it's really scary and hard. So we're diving into that. So to be clear, the native file system access API that we're working on will grant read and write access to local files. We're not fully converged on the fine details of the security model. Basically, it'll function by when the user clicks on a link, you'll be able to call an API, which pops up a file or directory chooser. The user chooses that file or directory, and then read access is given to that, which is pretty much what you can do today with input type equals file and drag and drop gestures. But then there'll be a follow-up way to request, I'd like write access. And we're still waffling on, should that be that now this PWA gets write access to anything, or that was brought in by the user? Or is write access coupled strictly to that one thing that was just accessed? Pros and cons to each in terms of what's most confusing, what's most understandable to users, what's the right security direction. So very active discussions here between the UX team, privacy and security, and the engineering team on this. Very closely related to this API is file handling. And again, there was a breakout session about this yesterday with the idea of literally letting users double-click on a .docx and have it open in web-based Office suite of your choice. And this will obviously be based on that same set of primitives, file handles, and so forth. And this will be available as DOM's tenants, as Dom mentioned in his talk yesterday, one of the tenants that we have is trying to not fork the web into installed versus running in a tab. One place, and so this would be available both to installed PWAs or apps, web apps running in a tab. One thing we might do differently between those cases is there persistence of write access? It may be that when you drag something in or open something, that if it's an installed PWA, it can save that file handle, say in IndexedDB, so that the next time when the user closes the app, opens it up again, they can implement a file recently used menu, or just reopen that same thing with write access. But that access would not be persisted if you were running in a tab. So still some things to work on. We've got a lot of interest from partners here, Intel, Microsoft, on contributing here, because obviously customers are asking them for this functionality as well. So as we are very close to refining that security model, we'll be breaking down in Monorail and CRBug the list of tasks and hopefully parallelizing the work and getting this to origin trial, hopefully in Q3. So that's one API, and that's sort of rather typical. There's a direct demand for it from customers. Very clear, lots of customers asking specifically for this thing. And that's true for many of the projects, many of the capabilities under the Fugu umbrella. Then there's another category, not totally distinct, but you know, maybe other end of the spectrum, around low-level APIs, low-level capabilities. This is where we fall into that camp of developers may have existing libraries that they rely on, they want to bring their app to the web, but those libraries don't have the low-level primitives to exist on the web, and so we want to expose those. Two examples are storage, and I did some digging, and I think I gave a lightning talk at BlinkOn in 2015 about this, saying, hey, anyone want to come help? Well, now we may actually have some folks to pick this up. And this is about supporting, again, bringing existing libraries that need to talk to disk to the web. Two cases there are things like, let's say you love SQLite, or you, perhaps more importantly, you love some other database engine other than SQLite, and you want to use that on the web. We need to provide the low-level primitives, pulling in individual blocks from disk, actually using primitives like mmap that exist in all operating systems, to allow really high-performant applications there. And that same thing applies not just to databases, but to applications that need to manage large amounts of memory and may be trying to implement their own virtual memory system. Audio device client is a proposal that came out of the web audio community group that's basically the same thing on audio. We've got high-level web audio API, and that's great for many uses, but if you're an existing game developer using FMod or Unity, or you're providing professional audio editing tools, it's not good enough. You need to go down to a level where you've potentially got a real-time thread, you're able to enumerate the hardware audio devices, Okay, a couple of examples. Now, depending on how much time we've got, quick look at a bunch of the other capabilities that are in progress, broken down by milestone, caveats, these dates, these are Chrome ship milestones, so this would be when something lands in stable, which for most capabilities means we've previously done an origin trial. As Daniel mentioned, we think the best path towards interoperability with other implementations is getting as much feedback from developers and potentially other browser vendors as possible, and we're not gonna skip that to get these out. So hopefully a lot of these will be available to play with several milestones in advance of these dates. And these dates are optimistic. We expect they'll slip, especially if we get lots of really good feedback that we need to respond to. Okay, I'm not gonna talk through all of these. These slides will be available online. As you can see, these all link to either explainers or draft specs or Chrome status entries, depending on how far along we are. You can also see, yay, the emojis worked. I've roughly tagged these on, are these of interest on mobile or desktop? We are targeting both. And like most of the work we do on the web platform, APIs do show up on both, with a few exceptions. So some stuff that's very close to being out there right now, the shape detection API, this exposes things like QR code detection and face detection. This is an example where native platforms have this. It varies across native platforms, but you know, Windows, Mac, and Android support this. Not plumbing this through to the web would keep the web as a second-class citizen in terms of app development. So we're going to do the work, or we've done the work, to expose these to the web. There will be the ability for web apps to query what types of detection are available, and this will vary across devices. We're not going to do the work of porting a large multi-megabyte library to all platforms. Maybe we'll do that for Chrome OS. Maybe there will be developer pressure to do that, but we're not going to restrict this API's availability where it already exists on native. There was already a breakout about WebShare Target, and zooming forward, badging of app icons coming soon. Contact Picker has been mentioned a lot here. This is the ability for, on mobile, for the web app to be able to just prompt and have the user select from a list of their contacts on the device and get email addresses or phone numbers. Very important in for social networks and in emerging markets. Notification triggers, this one's really cool. In the Chrome Apps API suite, there is the ability to just schedule a task in the future. If you're a Unix geek, cron jobs. It's cool, but there's a lot of issues with exposing that on the web. How do we keep the user in control of when this runs? Modern operating systems, mobile operating systems, really restrict this because they don't want arbitrary power usage in the background. But it's super important if we want to enable web apps to do things like clocks and alarms, calendar reminders. So if you scope it down from run some code at some arbitrary time to show a notification at some arbitrary time, there aren't the permission issues, assuming you've already got the notification permission. We may want to do the arbitrary task scheduling in the future, but going out with this immediately will unblock a lot of cases. Native file system should be landing towards the end of the year. Already talked about that. Several other APIs, including Serial and WebHID, that will be useful for talking to devices where USB or Bluetooth won't work. Riley Grant was gushing earlier about the number of developers that have come to him saying how excited they were about Serial. I think including folks in our data centers. Nifty. And then, you know, this is drifting into the very end of this calendar year into next, continued contributions from Google, contributions from some of our partners. Many of these may land earlier, they just don't have firm dates yet. I just want to call out that for the folks outside of Google that are working on these APIs, there are elements of our ship process, such as security, privacy, and UX reviews, that we haven't externalized yet. So it's very important to make sure that you're working closely with one of us to identify a champion within Google who can help drive that process with our security, UX, and privacy teams.
Cool. So as I alluded to, right, in order to make this program successful, not only there will be a lot of drive on Google, but also we also rely on all of you, right? So if you are a Blink dev who want to contribute, right, please look at CRBug. Look under the label Project Eagle Fugu and starting contributing to, you know, the area that you like. One thing we do ask is, like, you might want to focus on an area, like, instead of focusing on individual bugs, focusing on an area like desktop PWAs or networking or any big area that might have a bunch of related APIs that we want to develop, right? If you're an app developer, we also have a wonderful DevRel team who did a wonderful job making a blog post that outlines all of our in-progress APIs, right? That way it's much easier to browse than going through CRBug, right? There's links to the explainers. There are links to the Chrome status on when everything is shipped, right? And finally, there's a link to for you to file requests so that we can add additional capabilities onto our platform, right? Another thing that really demonstrates how good our capabilities is we want to have the ability for you to start thinking about migrating your Chrome app into PWAs, right? The reason why we're building so many capabilities is we believe that we can start bridging the gap and bring those apps onto the web, right? Josh?
Sure. Okay. That's about time, so thank you. If you want to get in touch, we're trying to coordinate as much as we can on the Chromium Slack channel, hashtag Fugu. We have, if you're a Googler, we have this wonderful internal go/Fugu site. We'll be working on bringing that externally as well, which just outlines, you know, process documents, who to get in touch with for various things. We also have a nifty, thanks to Daniel, very nifty timeline of the data that's derived from CRBug we can share. And again, if you've, you want to get a sticker, come hit us up after this. And I think we've got time for questions. Go Team Fugu!
Hey. I have three questions. The first one is like right in the beginning, you're talking about the like app gap, and you sort of translated that into the API gap. And my question to you guys is that if you think that like it would still be in the scope of Fugu to think about other things that are not necessarily new APIs that may be part of the app gap. I don't know, like maybe input latency is something that prevents some of those apps to exist. Like, and do you guys think that this fits is still in Fugu, or do you think we should be looking?
Yeah, so I've got a two-part answer to that one. One is the obviously the definition of what's a capability, is it part of Fugu, it's fuzzy. When I say I manage a capabilities team, everything we bring to the web is capabilities, it's fuzzy. I would say if it's something which is available on other platforms and is not yet on the web, that's definitely in scope for Fugu. What team works on it, who knows? So input latency, I would say that's more of a quality thing than the existence or not, but there may be nuances that I'm missing. One example that I skipped over in terms of a capability that's not an API, one of the things that existed as a permission that you could request with the Chrome apps manifest was unlimited storage. This is the ability to say, you know, I'm important, don't evict me, don't give me quota restrictions. We want to bring that to the web. And so we're tracking that as part of Fugu. We don't think that should be a permission because users won't understand it. We don't think there should be an API for it. We think it should be something which is made available. Maybe we say if you're an installed PWA, then you get unlimited quota. Maybe there are other heuristics that are involved. Maybe we can grant that to every site. What the interesting work that comes out of that is, okay, so what happens when sites take advantage of that, when the device gets full? So there is engineering work associated with that, but it's not an API.
The second question is, like, well, there's a big list of like P1s and P2s, and it's not crazy to think that like as we try to push this, like this, those things, we may be in territory where we will not be 100% sure that this is a long-term API. That like we may not be convinced that it's a great thing, even though we are can be pretty convinced that right now is a good idea. Mm-hmm. So it's not crazy to think that some of those things will fail, or we will regret some of those things in the long term, right?
Yes.
So then, do you think that it makes sense for us to put some effort in to sort of having a little talk about like some how the deprecation process of some of those things work out in 5-10 years in case like, because we had this thing right now, like for example, the HTML modules, and we try to disable and there's this big thing, and like, mm-hmm. Do you think it makes sense to also a little bit think about processes around like those things disappearing eventually?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I'll actually turn it back to, we're not treating this effort as getting any special treatment. So any one of the things within this Fugu umbrella goes through the same process of validation. Yeah, there's many things on that list. Also, if you dig into the Proj Fugu label, you'll find many things where there's a title and then there's no details. And this is something we heard somewhere. We saw there's a Chrome app API for this. and there's no further details. So just because it's on the list, on the backlog, doesn't necessarily mean we will do it or do it exactly as described. So that's part of it. We've also got the processes that we've learned very painfully about how to get APIs out so that we don't face this. And that's like doing origin trials, engaging as much as we can with developers, other browser engine vendors, other browser vendors, early, getting tag reviews, and making sure that this fits into our best guess for the future. I also think there's tension there. There was an excellent talk about Electron, and they pointed out, yeah, there's this gap. We will always be behind unless web and native platforms totally converge. Mm-hmm. Who knows? I think it's inevitable that there will be things that, like, should we go and do this? I mean, Touch Bar, I think that's been mentioned before. Don't know, how do we do this in a generic way? Or do we, we'll talk with customers, we'll talk with developers. It may be something that we come up with a great way to do it and then it fades out. I don't know.
Yeah, so I'd just like to add a bit more. So if you have something that you think it should be an API, please do not hesitate to open a bug, right? Like, we encourage all discussions, right? And we don't know where this API will evolve to. So when you first have thinking about, oh, this might work for this customer, it might be deprecating in a few years. It might actually be beneficial for another customer, right, that we don't know about. So it'd be nice to actually have that forum to start discussion on.
Yeah. And just to back that up even further, yes, we're really trying to be partner-driven, use case-driven for this. Yeah. We're not just, hey, here's a list of APIs, let's build them. Yeah. It's like very clear use cases, clear commitment from as much as we can from partners that they're interested in taking advantage of this. And an indication that this will get them more users, that this will benefit them.
My last question, which I'm almost sorry to ask, is you mentioned on the list of apps like IDEs as something that could potentially, there's another type of app that I didn't see on that list that sounds that we could maybe think about how to bring to the platform, which is a browser.
Self-hosting.
But in all honesty, it's a serious question. Like, is there a reason for, like, in the same way you could ask what's missing for Photoshop, you could also ask what's missing for Views to be on the web platform.
Yeah. And again, I think that comes to, are there places where there are new capabilities? So Views isn't necessarily a new capability. Why don't we build the UI using web tech? Well, that's more about performance rather than capabilities. In terms of the broader question of can you build a browser in a browser, that's a lot of the work that, a lot of that would be described by the extensible web manifesto, and really trying to say, we're gonna keep building things lower and lower in the stack so that we give you the network primitives, the drawing primitives, the storage primitives that you would need to build that.
Hi. So you kind of asked and answered the question I was going to ask about things like the Touch Bar, but I wanted to expand on that. So do you see a possibility or an avenue where an operating system or third parties could take this kind of Fugu space and extend it, but only on the one platform? So for example, Mac could inject a Touch Bar API or pass a capability in something like a platform specific, or because I'm trying to think of cases to address this gap where if the standardized web platform is always going to have this gap, could another party like backfill it?
Yeah, so that's definitely something that we've discussed. I would say in the grand semantic organization of things, that's probably that's adjacent to Fugu, but maybe outside. We've talked about it in various directions. Should there be some sort of escape hatch? We think that the best thing for nearly all of these capabilities is for us to follow the web standards process, like define it, make sure that it's maintaining the user's trust, safety, privacy, playing well with other parts of the platform. And it may be at some point that's something we'll decide, nope, we need to tackle this and figure out ways to do it. An example that one of the APIs that's interesting is local font access. And it's just being able to see, I'm a creative professional on my Mac, I've got 1,000 fonts. I'd like to be able to use them in my web-based drawing tool. And one thing that people do today is they will say, or one thing that app developers will do today is say, okay, install this local web server. And then our web app can talk to the web server running on your machine to get access to local capabilities. We would prefer that they don't do that because it opens up all sorts of security issues. But we need to, you know, pick off those APIs one by one or look at, are there more general solutions? So not out of the question, not something that we're going after at the moment.
To follow up on the question about implementing a browser in Fugu, what about implementing a web server in Fugu?
Ah, that's a good one. So again, ran out of time for this, but one of the categories like low-level storage, low-level audio, that we can imagine going after is low-level networking. We were kind of surprised when we started looking at the Chrome apps API usage, which helped inform a lot of our initial prioritization. And you know, I mentioned that file system access was the biggest one. Close behind that was the variety of networking APIs exposed to Chrome apps. As we started talking with partners, we found that nearly all of their use cases were covered by existing networking APIs, both just converting from the way they'd always been doing it in their native app to fetch, or to using WebRTC or WebSockets. There are some places where we'd like to make improvements into WebSockets, and there was a lightning talk yesterday that talked about exposing Quick to the web, which we think would be pretty exciting. The one thing those none of those covered was being able to run a local server. And actually, one of the cases, so I'm very interested in it. It wasn't on the list right now, but I think that's something we'll end up tackling. One use case, for example, I've mentioned to some people, is in places without great connectivity, very often a teacher can have their Chrome device running a local HTTP server, and the students, instead of having broad internet access, are getting their content from the teacher's server. We've heard this from some educational partners. And so I think we will have to come up with some solution there. I hope that doesn't mean we just expose native sockets, but maybe. I mean, maybe we come up with the right UX and security model around that. But yeah, that's definitely should be on, it's on the list, even though it's not something we're actively tackling this year. Okay, I guess that's it. I think following this, there's a coffee break, and then see everyone back here for lightning talks. Woo! And of course, if you want stickers,